I was blamed, manipulated into believing it wasn't the best thing to take it to the police.
I spent the first 15 years of my life as a Jehovah's Witness. Now, I want to know how this organization was able to control my family and to finally get answers to the questions I've had my whole life. Often poked fun at in popular culture, most people think of the Jehovah's Witnesses as those harmless Christians that knock on your door wanting to talk about God.
Yes?
Hello, we were wondering if we could talk to you about Jesus.
But what do we really know about them? They operate under a strict hierarchy topped by 9 men known as the governing body, based at their recently built worldwide headquarters in Warwick, New York, shown in the online videos. They have over 8 million members worldwide, with the UK home to around 130,000. They run a prolific media empire based around their Watchtower magazines and glossy online videos, driven towards increasing their congregation numbers worldwide. When I was young, I remember being shown upsetting pictures of the end of the world in my Bible study books, and I believed that if I wasn't perfect, I would die at Armageddon.
The minute you can read this book. I mean, it's available for everyone. There's no age limit. This one I still have nightmares over now.
This is called Revelation.
Really scary.
Nowadays, they use dramatic and forceful videos to warn of an imminent Armageddon when any non-Jehovah's Witnesses will be destroyed.
God's kingdom, represented by that stone, will crush all human governments at Armageddon.
It's also a religion that's repeatedly faced allegations of child sex abuse, prompted worldwide inquiries into its child protection practices. Victims have begun to speak out about how the organization has handled this. And I'm one of them.
You know, I was a child when things happened to me, and there's so many questions that I have that are not answered. And I think because there were so many restrictions put on us as children, shaped me to becoming quite rebellious as a teenager. God, yes.
You know, that's some of the things that I'm hoping to kind of get from doing this is, where do the decisions come from? Who makes the decisions? And, you know, what authority do these people have? Or do they just make it up as they go along? Some of the rules and regulations of this particular religion are questionable, to say the least.
I'm returning to Norwich, the city I grew up in, and where many of my family still live as Jehovah's Witnesses. I've not had much contact with my family since I left the religion at the age of 15, and I haven't been back here for almost 10 years.
I think it's going to be a bit strange seeing some of the things that I remember, but also some of the things that I've tried to form quite a comfortable distance with as well. Oh my God, I used to go down here when I was a child. Just going door knocking, always praying that someone from school wasn't going to open the door.
I always knew I was different growing up. We didn't celebrate birthdays or Christmas, and we were told we wouldn't be allowed a blood transfusion if we got sick.
This is so strange.
My first stop is my old Kingdom Hall, the place of worship for my congregation. This was the epicenter of mine and my family's life, where we used to come for services and Bible studies twice a week.
I remember parking around the corner and then walking through those double doors. The toilets were on the left-hand side, I think. There was 3 different rows of chairs sat out. And I would imagine there'd probably been around 100 and 150 members of the organization in that congregation. It's So these will all be going off on their service rounds. And this was my parents' life. This was my grandparents' life. My granddad was an elder in the congregation. He was well known, well liked, renowned for, you know, his belief in the faith. It's weird to think my nan still comes up here. I have not seen her for years either. You would have to do things to keep Jehovah happy because he was always watching. He was always watching who you spoke to, how you spoke, how you dressed, how you held yourself, how you conducted every part of your whole life. And we were told if we didn't pray enough, bad things would happen to us. But weirdly enough, as I was stood looking at that sign, I felt guilty. I think the guilt comes from going against everything that I was taught. Everything that you're taught not to do, I'm doing. Speaking out, questioning, bringing the religion's name down, and talking about, I guess, what goes on behind closed doors, because it's a very secretive community. It's a very secretive religion. Not many people know what goes on through those gates.
Do you not know that friendship with the world is enmity with God? Whoever, therefore, wants to be a friend of the world is making himself an enemy of God.
Every month, the most senior members of the Jehovah's Witnesses, known as the governing body, upload lengthy sermons to their website to be watched by congregations worldwide. I find some of these videos concerning because they teach that non-believers, also known as worldly people, are enemies of Jehovah and should be avoided.
We don't want to have any friendship, whether socially or on social networks, with Jehovah's enemies.
So our friends growing up were all members of Jehovah's Witnesses. They were all part of our congregation. And yeah, from very early age, you know, we were made to feel that we were different. We used to get bullied, we used to get picked on, called names, Johos, Bible bashers, door knockers. But at the same time, early childhood was living in a false sense of security. You know, the one place that you didn't feel judged and different was at the Kingdom Halls and going to the meetings, because everyone was in the same boat, or at least you thought. And it wasn't until things started going wrong within our family unit that bubble did burst, and actually the people that you thought were there to protect you and to support you and were like your brother and sister were actually not there at all.
Our congregation was a close-knit community led by the most senior members of the church, known as the elders. As well as leading the services, elders would provide spiritual guidance, and we were taught to fear and respect them. We had to go to them first with all our problems, no matter how personal.
So this was where I grew up with my mum, my dad, and my sister. And I remember my mum and my dad were really going through a tough time. There was a lot of arguing, a lot of, you know, upset. Whenever there was a problem, the elders would try and intervene. You know, they'd always be in the downstairs lounge, while us kids were usually in our bedroom, trying to calm situations down. And I think one of my last memories of here was it all kicking off. And then, yeah, and I think we left one night and never came back.
I was only 11 when my parents split up, and my mum moved us out of this house and out of Norwich. I've never understood the reasons, but in the eyes of the Jehovah's Witnesses, my mother had sinned. We were then shunned by our friends, and our family was divided. I've had a difficult relationship with my mum all my adult life, and we've been estranged for the last 7 years. So I never asked her what happened between her and my dad, or what role the Jehovah's Witnesses played in the end of their marriage. To understand more about the way the organization handles divorce, I've come to meet Ali Miller, who was born into the religion, but left in 2009 after experiencing a similar devastating family breakdown.
I think the public perception of Jehovah's Witnesses is quite character-like, isn't it?
But also, they have such a clever disconnect between who they are publicly and who they are privately, and it's strictly hierarchical. The elders are in charge of the congregation, and you are told as a woman that the husband is the head of the family. He can basically dictate whatever he wants to the wife.
Like many Christians, the Jehovah's Witnesses believe marriage is sacred and permanent. But unlike in other religions, divorce is only allowed in the eyes of God in cases of adultery.
I was married at 21, and it was a difficult marriage. And then when I was 27, I decided that I wanted to leave the marriage, and I had what they would class as an affair. And that was when three elders came up to my house with my husband present, who was a very controlling man. And they said that he couldn't leave the room, he had to be there, while I had to confess in detail to what had happened. And then the elders left, and they left me alone with him.
But that's very similar, because my dad and my mum split up. And I remember things like that as well, being interrogated by elders. You know, they were always involved. Whenever my mum and dad had issues, you were never allowed to deal with it outside the congregation. It was always internally dealt with.
On the Sunday, one of the elders got up on the platform and they didn't name names, but they basically told the whole of the congregation what I had told them in complete confidence. And it wasn't really very hard for people to guess who it was. I was a vulnerable woman and nobody said, "Are you okay?" They said, "We're going to judge you for that." People just stopped speaking to me. And my mother said that she had to remain loyal to Jehovah, and her loyalty to Jehovah meant that she couldn't see me anymore.
That's absolutely heartbreaking.
The Jehovah's Witness organization told us it is false to allege that when congregation elders decide whether an adherent should be expelled, they ask inappropriate questions. They also said they view men and women as equals. However, in accordance with the Bible-based beliefs and teachings, elders are male.
I think having met Ali, it's helped me understand the roles in the religion more, and actually probably one of the reasons why my mum and dad split up was because my mum had an affair. Well, I'm guessing that's what happened, because that's the only way in Jehovah's Witness organization that you can, in their eyes, divorce. But I soon realized that there was something that had happened, something that she'd done that wasn't acceptable, that was frowned upon, and that she must pay the price for.
New Finish Ultimate Plus, our next generation dishwashing tablet. CycleSync technology releases the right ingredient at the right time, and it all.
After my parents' divorce, my mum was what they call disfellowshipped from the Jehovah's Witnesses. As a result, we were rejected by family members and the congregation, who I believe were forbidden from associating with us. This is called shunning, and although it's not illegal, it's one of the most controversial practices within the organization.
I think I was about 11, I hated life. We lost communication with my nan and my granddad. They were no longer able to come and visit us. I just formed so much resentment to both my parents, really. And I think that's where my real resentment for religion started, was being made to feel so bad, so different.
To try and understand what happened to my mum, I've managed to track down two former members who held senior positions within the Jehovah's Witnesses and were responsible for disfellowshipping many people. Duncan Corbett and John Viney were elders for several decades before choosing to reject the organisation and speak out against its practices.
Can you just tell me, how did you become elders? Who ultimately gives you the so-called privilege?
Like everything inside Jehovah's Witnesses, it's all internal. It's kind of an old boys' club, really, if you want to put a label on it.
Jehovah's Witnesses believe you're appointed by Holy Spirit. So once you're appointed, your authority really can't be challenged, because people who are appointed by God, well, you better do what they say.
What are the rule books? Who creates this? Okay, I'm guessing it's a group of men again. But
good
do
guess.
You have a specific book if you like, need like help? Yeah,
one.
I recognise that one.
Yeah. Yeah,
my granddad
you've
was...
You've seen the elders book?
Yeah, I have.
Wow.
Well, my granddad was an elder. I always used to look, because this was... What was the sacred book, wasn't
yes,
it? No one
sacred.
Was allowed to look at it apart from elders.
Apart from elders. But basically, this is an instruction manual for every scenario you might come up with. How should I respond if somebody's accused of doing something wrong, some kind of sin? I think twice I've been on judicial committees that resulted in someone being disfellowshipped.
So talk to me about being disfellowshipped. How do you get to the point where you're shunned?
At the point where a judicial committee decides this person is not repentant, an announcement is made to the congregation, this person is no longer one of Jehovah's Witnesses. And every member of the congregation then would be expected to shun that person.
You know, that's family members as well. When my two daughters were disfellowshipped and I had to cut them off, you've got to be prepared mentally to completely view them as dead. And if they ring you up, you're supposed to put the phone down. Jehovah's Witnesses still call it a loving arrangement. Jehovah's loving arrangement.
But oh, it's nothing loving about that. It's
about
horrendous.
Them.
And all while they're disfellowshipped, they're still expected to attend meetings. I know from personal experience with my family, it's just a horrendous experience. And all that is in an attempt to make you even more repentant for whatever sin you've caused, to bring you back into the religion, to be reinstated as quickly as physically possible, because they want to show you what you've lost.
And I would say, you know, if you want to ask the question, is this a high-control religion, I would say that's one of the key questions you should be asking about any organisation. How do you leave? And if there is no gracious way to leave with family and friends' relationships intact, then yeah, that's high control.
To me, religion's not about control. It's not about being afraid to leave a religion for fear of losing your whole entire life. And I think that's why so many people do stay in it.
So I've managed to get a copy of the Elder's Handbook that Duncan and John showed me. It's not something that a normal, everyday member of the organisation would be able to get hold of. This is specific to elders and elders only. And it's quite fascinating because it includes a list of rules that you could be disfellowshipped for and sins that wouldn't be tolerated. Immoral conversations over the telephone or the internet, including sexting, misuse of tobacco, drunkenness, gluttony, obscene speech. You know, these seem really quite minor offences. A lot of it's based on the elder's discretion. And where does he make his judgment from? There's nothing that they specifically have to go through to get that job. You know, good people are being judged by unqualified members of the religious hierarchy. And by being greedy or gambling or swearing, you risk losing everything.
The Jehovah's Witnesses told us that the essence of the Elder's Handbook is available on their website. Very little research has been done on the impact of being disfellowshipped, so I've decided to contact a network of 1,200 former Jehovah's Witnesses to see if I can gather some data on how their lives have been affected since leaving the organisation. 188 responded to our survey, and the results were shocking. Over 80% of respondents, 155 people, said they had mental health conditions as a result of leaving the Jehovah's Witnesses. Over half told us they had suicidal thoughts. We put these statistics to the head of the Jehovah's Witnesses at their Chelmsford headquarters, also known as Bethel. They said, "The survey made by your editorial staff with disgruntled former witnesses seems not to consider that most former witnesses do not have feelings of hostility toward their former religion." They also told us, in relation to shunning once a member is disfellowshipped, individual adherents will decide whether to stop or limit contact with the person, and there is no change in the social relationship between immediate family members. They said courts have also rejected the allegation that disfellowshipping and so-called shunning result in social isolation and discrimination. And it is false to say they live cloistered lives, and simply misleading and discriminatory to imply that our religion is controlling. We've found a case of shunning that had devastating consequences. I've come to Glastonbury to meet with Julia, who's speaking publicly for the first time about what happened to her son.
Hi, Becky. Hi,
sweet. You too.
Come on in.
Brought up in a non-religious family, Lewis converted to the Jehovah's Witness organisation at the age of 19, after falling in love with a woman from America who he met online.
I'd love to start off by learning a bit more about your son, Lewis. What was he like growing up?
So he was his own little character. He was a bit of a loner. Found it hard to sort of make a group of friends, really. Easily led, probably. He was a worrier. He did worry about things.
Did you notice a big change in Lewis after he had become a Jehovah's Witness?
Yes. He thought that he had to set a very good example and be as perfect as he could be and live every day according to it. Otherwise, he's not serving Jehovah and not being a good witness.
After 7 years living in America, Lewis and his wife returned to the UK and joined a local congregation of Jehovah's Witnesses in Glastonbury. But he was under extreme pressure to earn enough money to provide for his wife and get her a British visa, and Julia began to worry about her son's mental health.
He was working two jobs and he wasn't sleeping and he was working all hours, and then if they had an argument, he would sort of disappear, take himself off. He just couldn't cope, and we did a couple of times have to say he was a missing person. So that was quite scary when he started doing that and started self-harming.
Did he get support from Jehovah's Witnesses?
Well, I thought he was, because he had, like, brothers and elders. I knew that they were the people that he would go to. And I just felt relieved that he had a group of people that he felt he belonged to, because I think that's important in life. I didn't realise a lot of what goes on in there.
Yeah.
But, yeah, it did become too much. He'd have a drink, trying to get to sleep. And then he started smoking.
And with his smoking, did he confess?
Yeah, because he knew he had to be honest. At one point, he had a couple of weeks to give up smoking or they were going to kick him out. I don't think they were worried about the fact that he was cutting himself or, you know, the other things that were going on. They were more worried that he was smoking.
In the Elder's Manual, Shepherd, the Flock of God, smoking and drinking is classed as a sin, and after failing to give up smoking within their time frame, Lewis was disfellowshipped, but was still expected to attend meetings.
It's almost like you're sat in the corner in shame, you know, knowing that these people that you thought were your friends aren't allowed to speak to you all of a sudden.
Yeah, I remember that all too well.
Said, no, we're not going to support you anymore. We're not going to be your friends. We're not going to even talk to you. No, that's cruel. It's really barbaric, really. Yeah. It was a Sunday morning. I was in bed and there was a knock on the door and I looked out and it was quite dark and I could just make out one person. So I came downstairs, didn't even notice that he had like a, you know, policeman sort of thing on. And he came in and sat down and said that Lewis had hanged himself in the night. I said to him, how ridiculous. How could you be so ridiculous to come and tell me this has happened before you go and check out the facts? And he had to say to me, well, he said to me several times, it is Lewis, it is Lewis. So I think just in complete denial.
I think we never think things like that are going to happen to our family.
Nope.
Oh, bless you. I'm so sorry.
Yeah. I used to tell him to write things down. I said, when you're struggling, write things down. So he'd write down about the Bible and how you're supposed to live and things like that.
He says, I'm not sure if Jehovah cares about me staying in his organisation or even on his earth anymore. If I stay alive, I'll carry on letting Jehovah down. He says, I'm sinful and will be until I'm in paradise. So why the pressure to be perfect now? Mm. It seems like it wouldn't really matter to them if I were gone. You've all let me down, treated me as disposable.
To think that that's how he felt, and knowing how unconfident he was anyway, and he had very low self-esteem, what was quite painful was that the friends who knew me and who knew Lewis's struggle, even they, as friends, didn't come to his funeral or come and see
That's
me.
Terrible.
Yeah, that was quite hard, I thought.
The Jehovah's Witnesses said that they don't have the information to comment on individual cases, but deny the implication that their beliefs relating to so-called shunning cause or contribute to suicide.
This is Wherryhill Hill. This is where me and the boys used to come after school in the summer and run about and run down the hill. And this is where we decided to scatter Lewis's ashes.
That's lovely.
Yeah, it's quite special to us. When I go outside and see the birds and the trees and that, I think, well, he's just part of, it's just back to nature now. And I like to imagine him on this bench, just looking at the view, and that gives me comfort.
Welcome to the best restaurant in town, Your Kitchen. Today's special, my pasta arrabbiata for less than £1.50 per portion. Boil your pasta, chop and sizzle the veg, bring all together with my...
Called a meeting. I think I was about 15. And I was told, well, actually it was suggested, it was put to me that I had misinterpreted the abuse for a form of affection. I knew that I hadn't. I was well aware of what was right and what was wrong, and was explained that I could potentially bring shame on my family, and basically manipulated into believing it wasn't the best thing to do to take it any further and take it to the police. The impact on me was wild. I was bunking off school, getting in trouble, making terrible decisions. And I remember there being a big argument and being told to get out and never to come back. Yeah, it's hard to see how I survived that. And I think it's not really until you have children that you really become fiercely protective.
but yet no one valued me enough to protect me. You know, my kids were everything. Sorry.
Recent events have made me realise I'm not alone in my experiences.
Australia has been given a rare insight into the workings of the Jehovah's Witness Church.
The commission has heard that thousands of sex abuse allegations have been covered up by the church.
Victims of child sex abuse from around the world have been coming forward with stories like mine of how the Jehovah's Witnesses have silenced them. It's resulted in investigations worldwide, including part of an inquiry in the UK.
Religious institutions are failing to protect children from abuse, according to the independent inquiry into child sexual abuse.
The 2021 inquiry found that the handling of child sex abuse within the Jehovah's Witness organisation lacks compassion for the victim and serves to protect the perpetrator. To find out exactly how the organisation does this, I'm heading to Galway in Ireland to meet a man who has dedicated the last decade of his life to gathering information on the organisation.
Hi, Jason. Hello. Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet
I'm
you.
Becky. Thanks
Very
for
welcome.
Having us.
So I have what I like to call the cabin.
Jason Wynne was disfellowshipped from the Jehovah's Witnesses in 2001 for having sex before marriage.
I'm loving the fact that it's all women doing this show.
Yeah.
It's really kind of
That's
a kick in the nuts.
Horrifying to them, won't it?
He was so concerned about the lack of transparency within the organisation that he's collated huge amounts of information from both current and former Jehovah's Witnesses.
This is amazing. Did you build this?
Yes, and I had to build it so big because I have so many hard drives in there with so much information relating to Jehovah's Witnesses.
Jason has an archive of private policy documents, legal evidence and correspondence with the Jehovah's Witnesses. Much of this was used to support the case against them in the independent inquiry into child sex abuse.
How do Jehovah's Witnesses, specifically the elders, deal with alleged child abuse in their congregation?
So in any kind of serious sin, including child abuse, there always has to be either two or more witnesses to the incident, or there has to be a confession. And they have a section here in The Shepherd, the Flock of God, says there must be two or three eyewitnesses, not just people repeating hearsay. No action can be taken if there is only one witness. So this is where it gets really complicated. Really, you don't have eyewitnesses to a crime of child abuse, unless it was a paedophile ring and they're all together. But which of these paedophiles are going to confess against the others? Highly unlikely, right? So it's up to the elders to determine whether they want to throw it out or not.
That's incredible.
The Jehovah's Witness policy on child sex abuse states, victims, their parents, or anyone else who reports such an accusation to the elders are clearly informed by the elders that they have the right to report the matter to the authorities.
The organisation will say that Jehovah's Witnesses do not prevent anyone from reporting child sexual abuse. What they mean by that is that if someone has been abused, they don't stop them from reporting it to the police. They are not talking about elders. So the point there is that it's the parents who have the responsibility to report, not the elders. And that's the way they've always operated about every type of activity. They use sophistry to be able to deceive their members, to deceive the courts, to deceive the governments, to deceive everyone, really. You know, we have had cases in Ireland and in the UK where elders have tried to report child sexual abuse, and any one of them that did report child abuse to the authorities, those elders were defrocked, or as they call it, deleted, and they're stripped off their titles. They were deleted in Ireland, they've been deleted in the United Kingdom. And usually the crime is not being loyal or lacking soundness of mind.
Hearing this shocks me, so I want to know more about how the organisation is discouraging people from reporting. I've discovered a woman from Northern Ireland who was a Jehovah's Witness for 50 years. Laura was sexually abused by a member of her congregation when she was a child. She says she repeatedly reported it to the elders. She has waived her right to anonymity to speak to me on camera for the first time about her experiences. How did he become known to your family?
Him and his family joined our congregation when I was about 7 or 8. His son and his daughter, we played together and, you know, we were in out of each other's houses. They were in our house to the Tuesday night Bible meeting. So they were, you know, we seen them mostly every day. I think after the third child was born, that's when the abuse started. But it was very, very subtle at first. So when he first started to hug me, I just thought, oh, well, he does have his own type, that's fine. And by the time I realised that there was something wrong, we were too far in.
And how old were you?
8 years old. I totally blamed myself. Totally. As most child abuse victims do.
Yeah.
Never even entered my head that he was to blame. You don't question. You do what an adult tells you to do.
Yeah.
Especially within the church. What he did was very painful, physically painful, more than anything. He injured me. And I was disgusted with myself. And I just go back into the bedroom and look in the mirror and call myself every name under the sun. I'm so ashamed. And I think that he stole my life.
Hmm. You were a child.
And you should have been protected by the ones that weren't protecting you.
Yeah.
When did you find the courage to speak to your parents?
I first disclosed the abuse when I was 17, and when I told my mum, she didn't believe me. I didn't disclose it really until years later, because I thought, if my own mother doesn't believe me, then no one's going to believe me. I'd actually went to see one of the elders. I told him who it was and when it had happened, and it was as if I had just told him I had chicken and chips for my dinner. He ignored it and moved on. So then it was another maybe 5 years later, I went to the elders again, and they said, okay, we'll ask him. And they come back to me and says, we asked him, he said he didn't do it, so that's the end of the matter.
Laura says she reported what happened to her to the elders a total of 3 times before eventually she went to the police.
Once I had reported to the police, the elders and the whole organisation just shut down to me.
Laura says the Jehovah's Witnesses delayed handing over evidence to the police regarding the meetings between the elders and her abuser.
On the morning, the elders involved in the case were supposed to be at court to give evidence and to be witnesses, and they failed to turn up. In the meantime, sort of to and fro and back between barristers, he eventually pleaded guilty.
What was his sentence?
18-month suspended sentence and 10 years on the sex offender register. And I'm being punished. I feel like I'm the perpetrator. I am literally being shunned because I reported a child abuser within their organisation.
We've also uncovered 3 cases similar to Laura's where elders in the Jehovah's Witnesses failed to assist in police investigations and hand over evidence. The Jehovah's Witnesses told us, elders are directed to immediately report an allegation of child sexual abuse to the authorities, even if there is only one complainant and no other corroborating evidence. They also said it is false and offensive to imply that they prevent the relevant statutory authorities from ensuring that crimes of sexual abuse are not perpetrated.
I think mine and Laura's lives have been quite similar, and ultimately her family chose religion over her, which will have a forever lasting effect on her. And similarly, you know, my family chose what they chose over me.
D Dimmer switches, guaranteed. Plumbing, guaranteed. Tiling, guaranteed.
Tradespeople so good, we guarantee their work for a year.
It's taken me decades to know this body. Laughter lines, grey hairs. And whilst you might not remember me, or the chicken pox rash I caused long ago.
Throughout the filming of this documentary, I've been trying to speak to a member of the UK branch committee to get answers about what happened to me in my childhood. They've declined my request for an interview, and their written response to my emails has failed to answer questions about my personal experiences. So I'm on my way to their headquarters, known as Bethel, to see if someone will speak to me.
Never been to the UK headquarters before. Had a look on Google Maps, and it's quite extensive. I understand it's over 82 acres, which is vast, and it cost them over £150 million to build, which is quite incredible, actually. Ultimately, this is where the decision makers in the UK are based. So hopefully today, it'll be our best chance to actually find someone that's willing to have a conversation. No response.
Hi, my name's Rebecca Vardy. I have sent an email request in to interview a branch committee member. And I'm actually outside your headquarters now. And I just wondered if there was anyone available to speak to me today. Thank you. This entrance alone would have cost thousands of pounds. Security alone. We're all on their wide TV screens right now. I think they've intentionally put me on hold, knowing that I'm outside, in the hope that I'll just go away.
Hello.
Hi. No, thank you. Oh, that's a real shame. I was really hoping to get someone in person from the organisation to actually speak to me and answer some of the questions I've got on my experience as a Jehovah's Witness as a child. So there's no one that would be willing to speak to me at all today. Okay, all right, thank you. Hope you have a lovely day. Thank you, bye-bye. It's been a really interesting journey. At the beginning, I felt quite a bit of guilt for speaking out against this religion, I think, because for so long it was part of my life. But I didn't make this out of revenge. I made this because I was looking for answers to what happened in my childhood, and unfortunately, those answers just haven't been forthcoming, which is a real shame. I don't like to apportion blame on people, especially family members. But I think since filming this documentary, I've formed a much wider understanding about how this organisation works, how they suppress people, how they force people to conform in a certain way. And that was what my parents were both involved in, and, you know, that's what wider members of my family are still involved in. And I think when you're so invested in that, it's really hard to see the bigger picture and see outside those four walls. And I think that's what makes this organisation so dangerous. So many of the people I've met whilst making this documentary have told me how they lost everything by leaving the Jehovah's Witness organisation.
But the freedom they all have now that they are out is an incredible feeling. Freedom to make their own choices and celebrate things like Christmas.
Enjoy yourselves. Have a happy Christmas and a free Christmas.
And tonight, I'm meeting a group of ex-Jehovah's Witnesses who have come together to celebrate this magical time.
And do what you like, because you're free.
Everyone I love and care about is now out. And it's so lovely to be able to live life to the full. So now we're out and celebrating Christmas. We've got 6 Christmas trees at home. We're now kids.
There's been a few of the stories that have resonated with me on a personal level. And it was quite nice, actually, to know that you hadn't been through that alone. I can close that chapter and move on.
And support information for the issues raised can be found online at channel4.com/support. Next tonight, lots to watch. It's Gogglebox.